So I play the Chebanenko Slav. It's also called the Chameleon Slav, against D4. And I think it's a really good pairing with the Scandinavian defense and with the London system. And I wanted to make a quick video to show the whole point or the reason for the move A6 in the Chebanenko Slav, because it can look kind of weird if you're not familiar with a few ideas and understand kind of the history behind it. So let's take a quick look at it here. The Chebanenko Slav is this move A6 right here. But let's just back up a bit and just talk about the Slav in general. So the Slav was developed after the Queen's Gambit Decline was used, because if you look at the Queen's Gambit Declined, it locks in this light squared bishop. It kind of bites on that e6 pawn, and that can be a bit of a problem in why White gets a slight advantage for the most part against the Queen's Gambit Declined. So Black got the idea to start playing c6 to not block in this bishop with the e6 move until after the bishop gets developed outside that pawn chain, and then to play e6 potentially. So, and then as far as the Slav in general, the idea of the Slav would be to develop this bishop to f5 or to g4, then to play e6. The knight would have already been on f6. Develop the dark squared bishop to either e7 or d6, and then knight b to d7. And that's kind of like the standard development scheme that you aim for if you're a Slav player. And the cool thing about the Slav, or one of the cool things about the Slav, is you can try to aim for that development scheme against any non-e4 opening. So, you can kind of go for this general plan if they play knight to f3 on move one, maybe if they play c4, the English, even if they play something weird like b3, you can go for that standard Slav setup. So it's kind of cool in the sense that it's universal, and then you don't have to learn a system against all these other openings. So let's get back into the Slav position here. So this is how it would usually open up. And here, the mainline Slav is to play d takes c4. And that seems a little bit weird. Why would Black just relieve the tension and give away the center? And the point of it all revolves around the viability of getting this bishop outside of the pawn chain. So let's look at why, to understand the reason that Black takes the c pawn here, and abandoning the center so quickly. Let's try to understand why that is. So let's look at what happens if Black just goes about trying to get that Slav setup we just looked at and plays bishop to f5 right away. Well, White has this annoying resource where they capture our d pawn and then hit us with a quick queen to b3. So that's the problem with playing this bishop out right away, is if you look at it, we got two problems here, and the queen can't solve both of those problems by itself. So, ironically, the best move here for Black is probably to move, admit the mistake, and play the bishop back to c8. So obviously that's less than ideal. So that is why Black started relieving the tension and abandoning the center by taking this pawn this early, is to avoid these queen to b3 ideas, with the exchange on d5 and hitting these two things simultaneously. And but by doing that, the advantage for Black is that it does maintain the ability to keep make this piece active, this light squared bishop, and get it outside the pawn chain. So that's what people typically think of as the Slav, and that's the reason that it developed. So if we look at the Chebanenko Slav, so instead of taking here, the Chebanenko Slav is a6. And while that might look kind of strange if you're not familiar with some of those ideas, But the point of this is to also protect against this same kind of idea. So let's just say white plays e3. Well, now we can develop our bishop, you know, outside of the pawn chain. And the cool thing here is that these tricks no longer work for white. So if white tries this same trick, now we have two resources available to us by this a6 move, by the fact that we made that. One is that we could play rook to a7, and this is one common way of doing it. And that protects the b7 pawn. The other thing we could do is just play b5. And the same idea would also be the case if instead of taking on d5 first, if white just said, well, I'm going to come out here and basically threaten the same thing, we would still actually have both of those options available to us. We could just play rook to a7, or we could, even if we wanted to, we could play b5, and those are both viable options. And they were both enabled by playing this a6 move. So I think this is a good opening, especially for adult improvers, because, you know, if we look at this Slav, I think it has some general advantages, in the sense that it's very ideas based. So our idea, the whole point of this a6 is to enable us to try to move forward with our standard Slav development. Bishop to f5 or g4, e6, bishop developing, knight b to d2, and castle kingside. And we're much more likely to get this kind of standard development than if we played like the mainline Slav, or if we played the semi-Slav. There's a lot more, they're more complex, and there's a lot more setups that can be used by both white and black. And so I would say the Chebanenko is kind of more of a compact repertoire, in the sense that if for some reason white wants to keep us from going about doing our standard development here, that we just showed with, you know, our bishop out and then e6 and then developing by standard Slav, then there's about four different general plans that black has of different ways to set up our pieces. And the cool thing is like, if you know what those four plans are, then you don't have to spend all kinds of time memorizing all kinds of different sharp lines. There's a good chance you'll be able to figure it out on your own over the board if you understand those ideas. And the vast majority of the time, we're just going to end up in our standard Slav setup anyway. White has to really know some stuff, you know, if they want to try to take us out of just our kind of simple development. So for that reason, I think like A6 is a really good move, a really good opening for adult improvers. And I think what I'll do is sometime here in the near future, I will do a video on the different development plans for black if we can't just go about our standard Slav setup like this. And like I said, there's four development schemes. And the idea is if you know those four development schemes, you figure out which one to play if they kind of shut down our typical Slav play. So anyway, I hope you got something out of that video. I enjoy playing the Chebanenko Slav. Oh, I'll mention one thing too. One cool thing about the Chebanenko is you will be surprised how many people will just think like you're a Potzer or a Guppy or something when you play A6 and you're just kind of passive and you don't know what to do. And, you know, like I've had this move played against me a bunch of times. And the cool thing about the Chebanenko is we are actually threatening to just grab that pawn and hold on to it. And I've done that a number of times. Because like they just kind of play along like they're playing a standard standard regular Slav. And you know, they'll play like a4 here, and then the most common thing will be to play, you know, one of the common things will be to play bishop to g4, and they think, oh, this person didn't even take on that pawn, so I don't, you know, they didn't even take that pawn, so I don't have to worry about playing a4. Hell, I'll just play bishop g5 right away. Well, that doesn't work out so well for them, and I've had that come up a number of times. So that's one of the cool things about the Chebanenko is you'll actually get some easy advantages out of the opening for people that don't understand that they are in danger of just losing this pawn. So anyway, I hope that was helpful. Have a good one.